Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. My name is Darby Dickerson, and I'm the new dean here at the John Marshall Law School. I'm very excited to be in Chicago and to have launched a new series of conversations with the dean. This is the second in that series, and we are thrilled to have with us today Lieutenant General Flora Darpino. She's the 39th Judge Advocate General. She's the first woman to hold that position. She's a graduate of Gettysburg College and of Rutgers Law School. And I'm going to allow her during our Q&A session to tell more of her story. But please join me in welcoming to John Marshall, General Darpino.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. We're going to proceed in the Q&A format. At some point, I'm going to open it up to audience questions. We have a mic in the center.
Can you hear me now? Okay, wonderful. So we'll have some Q&A opportunities for the audience. If you could come to the center mic, that would be fantastic. The other thing, if you didn't know, one reason that we were able to get General Darpino here is she is winning one of the Ms. JD awards that will be given tonight at Jenner and Block. So we thank her for making this detour with us here in Chicago. So let's just start off.
Okay.
Tell us your story and your background. Where did you grow up? Where did you go to school? How did you decide on the Army? How did you decide to be a lawyer?
Well, I come from an Italian-American background, so all my grandparents came from Italy. And we started out in South Jersey in an agricultural community. My father was a dirt farmer. That's how he used to call it, at least. Grew up in abject poverty. And then due to the GI Bill in World War II, he was able to get a college education. And that changed the trajectory of the Darpino family. So Darpino is my actual name. I'm married to a good Irishman by the name of O'Brien. And so we moved all over in agricultural communities through Delaware, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Jersey, South Jersey, the part that gives it the Garden State, which most people, they ask what exit. That's not what Jersey looks like. It's a Garden State. So I came from the garden part. When I was in college at Gettysburg College, I met a boy, and we started dating and got very serious. But I was not going to follow no boy nowhere. And so when we went off to law school, we went to two different law schools. He went to West Virginia. I went to Rutgers. He was also a Jersey guy. And he was an ROTC student, meaning a reserve officer training candidate, which meant that since they paid for his college, he now owed them time. And so as I was sitting in law school doing moot court, my moot court professor asked me, what is it that you're going to do when you graduate? Because I loved oral advocacy. I loved trying the cases. I loved writing the research and writing part of it. And I said, well, I don't know. I have to wait and see where my husband is stationed, and then I'll decide. And he was the one who turned to me and said, why don't you join the Army also? And I thought, that's the craziest thing I've ever heard in my life. Why would I ever join the Army? And the more I thought about it and the more research that I did, the more I realized that, you know, why wouldn't I join the Army? Why wouldn't I take that chance on myself? And in the back of my brain was, if I can do 3 years of law school, and get through that, I can probably do 3 years in the Army and get through that, which is what my first contract was. So the boy I wasn't going to follow nowhere, I followed into this career. And 30 years later, I am happy to announce that the career and the marriage both worked. So.
Talk to us about your career trajectory. You joined the JAG in 87. And here you are at the pinnacle. How did it all fit together?
I don't really know how it happened. You know, sometimes things just happen by chance. So I came in the Army when there were only 8% women in the Army JAG Corps. So I came, you know, there were very few women in the legal profession at that point in time. More women were going to law school, but still a minority, not like it is today. And so I chose a male-dominated profession, the law, and then a male-dominated organization, the Army. and I really didn't know what to expect. My husband and I ended up getting stationed in Germany for our first assignment. And so I was really glad I made that decision because I could definitely not have been practiced law in Germany. And so he and I went to our first duty assignment, and I walked into my first office, and my boss looked at me, and he said, "I told them not to send me a woman, but they sent you anyway." And it was kind of a moment in my life. I sort of sat there and I thought, well, several things could happen here. I could say, woe is me, or I could think about what my dad taught me and my mother, you know, that in order for you to be accepted in society and to be considered equal, you may just have to work a little bit harder than everybody else around you. And so I thought about what he said again, and he said, "I didn't want them to send me a woman, but they sent you anyway. And I said, "I'm going to focus on the second half of that sentence. They sent you anyway. There's somebody out there somewhere, the great and wonderful they, who have decided that I can do this job. And I'm going to prove them right, and I'm going to prove him wrong." And I just worked my hardest. And from there on out, just, you know, I think working hard and showing people that I was competent and capable and I had a commitment, I just get put into positions of continued responsibility. I've got to say there weren't challenges along the way, but it was really other people's faith in me that I think kept propelling me to the next level.
What are some of the assignments you had along the way? And one thing I'm curious about, you said that you and your husband had your first assignment together in Germany. Have you been able to be substantially together during your careers, or have there been periods of long separation?
In the beginning of our careers, we were together regularly. And but we were always went to very large places. So, you know, we have some folks in the back row there that are from MEPS and Great Lakes, right? Which is a small legal office. There's a lieutenant colonel and a captain. And then we have one of their civilian attorneys who is also in the JAG Corps and is reserve component. My husband and I could never go to that place. It's a great assignment, but we could never go there. It's too small. So we went to big, big bases. And then the DC area where they were. And so through our career, we were able to stay together, doing, you know, two different jobs, raising two daughters. We have daughters who are 26 and 24 years old. And then the war hit. You know, 2011, we were at Fort Hood, Texas, which is in Killeen, Texas, outside of Austin. And I was standing in an office in my physical training uniform because they had some emergency that they needed me before I could get out of, you know, do PT early in the morning, take a shower, go to work. And I was standing in their office, and the person I was with looked up his TV, and he and I watched the towers start to fall because of the time zone change. And he called the general into that same office because I was up in the general's office. And then the three of us watched the second go down. And that's kind of when it changed. I mean, that's kind of when it changed for all of us, right, that day. And so from that moment on, my husband and I really realized that we may not always be stationed together, that what was more important was what the nation needed. We had been in the Army for, you know, 20 years, and that we had to do what we had always promised to do. And so I headed off to Iraq. Came back after my tour in Iraq, about 3 months together, and then he headed to Iraq. And from there on out, we've had times where we were separated because that's what the Army needed us to do. But we were also senior. Had we been younger, we probably would not have been separated the amount of time that we were. So you think, you know, okay, mom of two daughters, and you say, you know, you've always feel, my husband too, you feel like that little bit of guilt. I missed, you know, two proms. I missed one of the two high school graduations. I made it home for my oldest daughter's graduation on the weekend. And so I missed stuff. And I always felt a little bit guilty about that. And I was going back to Iraq on one of my tours, And I opened up my bag when I got back to my office, and out felt a note from one of my daughters. And so I've kept two notes in my lifetime in my jewelry box. First was one from my husband when he told me that he loved me the first time. He was a coward, he did it in writing. And the second time was this note, and it sits in my jewelry box. And in that note, she says to me, you know, I know you feel bad about going back. I know you feel bad about, you know, not taking a Carrie to college, because she was heading off to college, the younger sister, missing stuff, whatever. And she said, but you make me so proud, and I'm proud to be your daughter. And that what you have shown me you can be as a woman is important. And so you should not feel guilty about this. I love you, Mommy. Something like that, because maybe I've read it more than once. but so you do, you know, there are sacrifices as a member of the military. There, you know, you do it for the American people. And when you make that commitment, you can't say, oh, it's hard now. I'm not going to do this anymore. You know, you got to keep doing it until they tell you it's time to go, you know, which I'll be retiring in about 5 months. It's time for me to go and make room for others to take my seat.
How did you learn you were going to become the JAG?
I received a phone call from the then chief of staff of the Army. He and I had worked together when I went to Iraq the first time. He was my commander. And then General Odierno was who the individual was. And then when I went to Iraq the second time, he was the commander there. And so I had worked for him a couple times. And he called me on the phone and told me I was the commander of the Judge Advocate General's Legal Center and School, which is our schoolhouse in Charlottesville, Virginia. It's an ABA-accredited school. We give ABA-accredited LLM for our graduates that go there. And actually was the commander when Lacey went. I handed him his diploma as he walked across the stage. And he called me and told me. And I was shocked. I laid in bed for about 3 to 4 nights in a complete state of panic. And then I went back to what I said at the beginning. They sent me anyway. And so I said, somebody has faith in me. They think I can do this job. And I am going to work my very hardest because I will not let them down. And that's what I've tried to do for the last, you know, 3.5 years. Work my very hardest. And hopefully some of the people will decide I haven't let them down, but that will be for history to decide, I guess.
One thing that you said, and we had talked about this when we got to see each other a little bit earlier at Texas Tech, but mm-hmm. You're retiring in 5 months. Why are you retiring?
Well, it's a 4-year term appointed by the president, and when those 4 years are over, you retire. So there's no place left for me to go. But if I could wind back time 31 years, and start over again, as long as I got back my 25, 26-year-old knees, I would do it all over again. Even if I was starting right now, and where we are in history right now, I would do it all over again. Or at least I'd make that 3-year commitment, you know? Because I love what I do. I mean, I'm one of those lawyers that absolutely loves what I do. Every day I go to work.
And tell us, what do you do as the JAG? What are your responsibilities?
So I wear 3 hats. My first hat is that I'm a legal advisor to the Secretary of the Army and the Chief of Staff of the Army. And there's a statute that was passed a number of years ago when there was a group of civilian leadership trying to get between the judge advocates and leaders regarding enhanced interrogation techniques. And so we as experts on the humanitarian law, the law of armed conflict, the Geneva Conventions, there were some civilian leaders that tried to block the TJAGs from getting in to talk about the legality or illegal use of interrogation techniques, enhanced interrogation techniques. When that statute was, so they passed a statute that said No one will ever stand between the TJAG and the Secretary of the Army and the Chief of Staff of the Army when it comes to giving legal advice. And so that's my first task, is to work with the staff to try to make sure that the advice that they get is appropriate. But if not, I have to have the moral courage, even if it means I get fired, to go in and tell the truth. My second job is that I am the legal advisor to the Army staff. And so all the policies and all those sorts of things that happen on the Army staff that you read about in the paper, you know, when you open it up and you see like transgender policy or you see, you know, religious accommodation, even the emoluments clause, you know, we're advising on that. And so that's my second duty. And then my third is I'm the head of the branch. So the Judge Advocate General's Corps is 10,000 members strong. We have active, reserve, and USAR and National Guard. We have civilian attorneys, and we have uniformed and civilian paralegals and paraprofessionals. And they're one of all of those categories sitting in that row back there, coming from the MEPS station, the MEPS headquarters. And so I am responsible to make sure that they're trained and ready to go. And then I also make sure that the right people are in the right place. So I do all the assignments for those individuals. And we do talent management. So I individually assign everybody who's been in the Army for about 8 to 10 years or longer. And so I spend about that amount of time on each, I spend about 30% of my job on just the JAG Corps.
So it's great to hear anyone who loves their job, and especially a lawyer who loves her job.
Yeah.
But tell us the favorite part of your job at this point, and maybe share the least favorite part of your job.
I would say the favorite part of my job is making sure that I'm fulfilling the prophecy that every Army officer has to, which is that you train and mentor your people so that you become completely irrelevant. Because the way the Army is built and the formation, and I'd ask you just think of pictures you see of the Army, you picture 5 or 6 individuals, you know, shoulder to shoulder with weapons outside a doorway about to go in. And that's what you think of when you think of the Army, that squad formation. And there's a leader, a squad leader in that formation. The Army trains their people so that if you as the leader go down, that your squad can continue that mission when they go through the doorway. And so we're charged to not only do our own job very well, but to make sure that everybody that we are responsible for is able to do their job, and that if we are not there, that they can do it without us, and that they will be able to step up into that leadership position at a moment's notice. And that's what I love about what I do. I still get to practice law. I have people come in my office down to the captain level, which is our junior officers, and I mentor and train them on the law. I mean, I might know the answer, but what good does that do? Send them back out, have them look at stuff. And then I set up the training for the JAG Corps when I wear the other hat of being the chief of the branch. I would say the part that I like the least is that when I know, because I hold professional credentials for others, when I see a judge advocate who has failed to have the moral courage to stand up and say no when they need to, and then I have the burden of disciplining them in some fashion. They've let me down, they've let the Corps down, they've let the Army down, and so I must take action. But it's the least favorite part of what I do, because I wonder sometimes, am I somewhat responsible because I failed them in their training?
What do you look for? You said that you give assignments for about 8 years up. So when you're looking to put someone in a position, I think of this as akin to hiring. So when you're thinking about hiring someone, what are some of the qualities that you're looking for? And What are some of the qualities when you see them you want to sort of run the other way, even though you're in a very different circumstance? You probably have to make the assignment as opposed to always terminating someone. But
right.
And stated differently, what makes someone successful in the JAG Corps and what means someone probably needs to leave?
I think to be successful in the Army, we are a profession. So when you're a member of the Judge Advocate General's Corps, we're talking about uniform personnel now, you're a member of two professions. You're a member of the Army profession, which has standards and professionalism, and you're a member of the profession of law, which has standards and is also, you know, a certain type of professionalism. And so I think that, you know, the standards of professionalism apply to both, and that's what we look for, either that they have it and that they have the potential to serve at the higher level. And those are competence, character, and commitment. And so to translate that for a lawyer, competence is you have to do it right. Okay, we don't have the luxury of being right 80% of the time. Okay, we got to be right 100% of the time. And if we don't, then we've failed our clients. Sometimes we make mistakes, and when we've noticed those, we look for the corrective action, you know, because we're not perfect, but we have to do it right. So that's the competence part. And that's why professional education is incredibly important and why self-development is equally important. Aside from competence, then there's character. And I had already talked a little bit about that. Being a judge advocate is not for the faint of heart. Okay? And so as any lawyer, we have to tell our clients no. But for us, you know, sometimes we're in a remote location and they're trying to do the right, they want to do what's right. That's the best part of our clients. They want to do what's right. But sometimes you have to tell them no. You can't do that. And it takes a lot of moral courage to say that in a room full of people. And I'm just going to give you one example. This isn't my story. It's someone else's story. But in, you know, Iraq at one point in time, there was a IED maker. And they were trying very hard to find this IED maker. They ran into a young boy on the street who, you know, said he knew who the IED maker was. But if you've ever been to Iraq or any of those other countries, there aren't like street signs. It's not laid out on a grid. It's not, you know, it isn't like you could just go to someone's house. They'd give you directions. And so the young boy said he could take them there. Well, once it comes back to the, you know, can we in fact put this young boy who is not of age of consent in a military vehicle, drive him to a location so he can point out an IED maker? Can you do that? And the lawyer in that situation to make the make the call that's putting a civilian improperly at risk, particularly when they can't consent to the risk that they're assuming because the child wasn't old enough to make that decision. And the lawyer said no. And obviously the commander could decide, but he said, no, it's not the right thing to do. The commander concurred. And that night, sitting in the back, you know, what we call the TOC, the Tactical Operations Center, the IED went off, and they knew that those soldiers lost their lives. And again, that lawyer felt somewhat responsible. That's why being a judge advocate's not for the faint of heart. The rule of law is important. And it isn't all means necessary with no limitations. That's what humanitarian law imposes on us as, you know, war fighters. So that's the character part and why that's so important. And then there's the commitment part. And the commitment is that it can never be about you. And sometimes, you know, we all want to be recognized for the great legal opinion we gave, or we want to make a decision because it's right for our organization. But we're public servants. And so it's never about us, and it's never about our organization. We have to do what's right. And so that's what we look for in people, or I look for in people. And what I run away from is somebody who shoots from the hip on a legal opinion and puts their client at risk, doesn't have the diligence to do the hard work, and then let me find out you're a yes man. If you're a lawyer and you're a yes man in my business, that's problematic. And commanders will actually come up to me and say, I love my lawyer. They always seem to get to yes. And I'll be like, do they tell you no? Oh, of course they tell me no. That's all I need. Then I'm like, okay. But if I hear that someone, oh no, they always get me to yes, it's a little mental note. I got to be concerned about that. Because the answer is no sometimes. It's never always yes.
What advice do you have for law students or young lawyers who might be thinking about applying for JAG? Okay. What steps can they take? What do they need to be thinking about beyond things you've already shared?
Yeah. I think that if you're interested in military service, you have to remember that you are in a dual profession. Okay, and obviously I'm about to retire. I already confessed about my knees. You know, it's a young man's business. And when I say man, that means man or woman. So I'm not being sexist up here. Should use guys. I'm from the Philadelphia area mostly. Guys is gender neutral. It's a young guy's business. Because you're a dual professional. So you have to be really good at being in the profession of law. But you're a soldier. And so you have to want to do that part of our job. You can't expect to come into an office and sit behind a desk. You have to be proficient on all your what we call warfighting tasks. You have to be physically fit. You have to be able to shoot your weapon. You have to do all of those things. You have to be prepared to deploy and serve your nation in harm's way. And so that's number one. You have to be ready to be a soldier. And the other thing is you have to remember that you're not going to be doing the same thing forever. Because when we plop you down somewhere in the world, you have to be prepared to do more than one type of law. There's no such thing as a specialty. There's specialized expertise that you could maybe concentrate on, but you never just get to do one thing through your entire career. And you also don't get to stay in one place. So if you don't like change, yeah, you're going to have a hard time. Because it's all about change. It's all about making you better in the whole toolkit that the Army needs from you. So we're going to move you around, and we're going to make you uncomfortable. We're going to make you do things you don't think you're capable of. And when you get to the end, you're going to be like, oh my gosh, like, I did that. I deployed, I did that. And that's why I think talking to some of these other people in the audience that have been through some things that more recently, you have to be willing to do both. So what can you do to make yourself more attractive when it comes to the Army JAG Corps? Obviously a dedication to public service, because we ain't gonna pay you a lot. We're just not gonna pay, we are not. Job satisfaction comes at a price, right? You have to be physically fit. And so you have to be willing to do that. We've had people lose 150 pounds. This last board I selected, someone lost 150 pounds to come into the Army JAG Corps. This is what they wanted to do, and they were committed to it. And so they had that commitment. And then you just have to be a good lawyer. I don't need number one from Harvard. If number one from Harvard is physically fit and wants to do public service, that's great. But I'd rather have somebody who has all those characteristics, because I got nowhere to hide this smart guy. They've got to be able to do the other stuff. And the last part of that is you have to have communication skills. So we are in the, you know, we have to be able to talk to our client in their language, which is no different than any other legal profession. It's just that our clients speak a different language than anybody else. And so you have to be able to communicate.
Can you share with us some information about one or two of the mentors that you've had along the way and how they've impacted your career and your life?
Mentors. Okay, so when I first came in, my greeting by my boss, but what I found was that if I worked hard and demonstrated my competence, it became gender neutral. So in my generation, I knew that I always had to work harder than the guy next to me in order for me to be considered equal. But what I also found were that there were people along the way that they were all about promoting, and I don't mean like as in rank, but promoting diversity. Because it's very important that the folks that are officers look as much as they can like our enlisted rank. And so nobody in the JAG Corps ever held me back from jobs. I remember being pregnant, about to get on a bus in Germany, and a female officer pulled me aside and said, "You can't have a baby. You didn't establish your reputation yet." I was like, "It's a little late." And she was wrong, because my boss didn't think twice about the fact that I was pregnant. And that was someone that you know very well, General Walt Hudson, who became the T-JAG like me. So, you know, he at that time in history, in the late 80s, knew that it was irrelevant as long as I could do my job. And that's the guy the JAG Corps promoted. The guy who said, "I didn't want you because you're a woman," he did not get promoted again. And so the Corps has always been very, very welcoming. We're now 27% women. So from 8 to 27% in my lifetime. So I don't have any specific mentors. It was people who I think gave me a chance to prove what I could do. And then they'd say to someone else, "She's really good." So I think that's my answer.
I think we've gotten a little bit of a sense of this next answer, but what is your leadership philosophy?
It is that I need to train and mentor so that I become irrelevant. Because you do, either in that moment or for me in 5 months. No one's gonna remember me except for my face being on a poster somewhere, you know, that they have of all the judge advocate generals in the history. You know, it's the next guy. And so if I have not paved the path for the people who are following me, then I have failed as a leader. And what that takes a lot when you're younger is, like I said, you may know the answer to the question. Oh, good for you. You might be the smartest guy in the room. That doesn't help the organization. So you gotta help your captain become the smartest person in the room for when you're not there. And so to us, it's servant leadership is what it is.
Knowing everything you know now, what is one skill you wish you had developed earlier on as an attorney?
I think written advocacy. I think we spend a lot of time thinking about oral advocacy. And, you know, I thought that that's what I wanted to do, try cases forever, even though anybody who's done trial work knows it's a lot of written motions. But I thought, you know, as a young attorney, I was just going to try cases and this was going to be great. And then I realized that cases are made or lost often on written advocacy. And that if I didn't become persuasive in the written word, that was going to be problematic. And then as you become a more senior lawyer and you start out with one-page memos that you've got to convince somebody, and how about over to my lifetime, a paragraph on email where I have to, if I can't convince them of everything, I have to make them aware enough of the issues that they're like, oh no, I better call Flora down to my office or make time on my calendar. And so it's that written advocacy and the art of the selection of words that I think I wish I understood at the beginning, because I would have taken more time when I was younger learning that instead of waiting till I was more senior and struggling a little bit more.
To the extent that you're able, what are some of the legal issues that the Army is facing that you have to give advice on, or those in the Corps need to give advice on?
Well, I mean, in the Corps, it's going to depend on what level you're on. And I mean, I think these guys in the back would be great to ask questions about what kind of legal advice that they have to give on a regular basis. For at my level, you know, every decision is a big policy decision has incredible ramifications. So let's just talk about growing the Army. So there's discussions about our end strength going up, and boy, that sounds great. You know, but there's lots of legal issues. So where do you get the money for that? Because we're appropriated money from Congress for specific reasons. And do we have enough money for us to actually do that? Who can approve bonuses for soldiers to reenlist? Let's give everybody a bonus so they don't get out. Who has the authority to approve that, even if you have the money? And so then how does that program get structured when it comes to the contracts that soldiers sign? You know, does it just a promise? Like, do they just sign something, or do you need an actual additional contract, an addendum? And so those are all, I mean, that's just one example of that day. Look at a hiring freeze. I mean, I have a book already this thick in my office on the hiring freeze and the policies we're going to do to implement that. You know, and so folks are immediately in the papers, you'll start reading about childcare. Well, sure, it says there's an exemption for childcare. What's the standard? Who has the authority to approve it? What kind of money can you use for that? And so it just, things become very complicated, which is why I say you're not going to just practice one area of law, because each one of those problems had all different issues, contracts, fiscal, ethics, I mean, all different areas of law, which is why we train our lawyers like in-house counsel, which is what we are. You don't have the luxury of just knowing tax law. So
changing gears, what are your hobbies?
Well, when I was younger, my hobbies were my children, okay? Until they abandoned me and went out and got lives of their own. And so I laugh about that, but I am flying to see both of them this weekend, so that's probably not necessarily true. But I'm a gardener. I have a very formal gardening style, like an Italian gardening style. I was out there 2 weeks ago for like about 8 hours because we have an early spring and I had to make sure that I had gotten all my plants in order. I didn't expect that. And I love to cook. I married an Irishman who ate only meat and potatoes. I convinced him to eat vegetables at some point. And now he's become a foodie. And so the two of us love to cook together. And I do love to read still. And I try to read on weekends, but I have a lot of homework, as it's been called over my, that's what I called it when my kids were little, mommy has homework. And so I often have homework on weekends, but I try to read a lot.
What are some of the things that you are reading now or you've read recently?
Okay, so how many of you here have like iBooks or the Nook or that kind of thing? Okay, do you know the titles of the books you read now? It's so hard because like you used to pick it up and you'd see it and you don't anymore, right? So it makes it difficult to remember what the book. So I just finished a book. Okay, so I talked about self-development and I also think it's important to have fun. I know this doesn't sound like fun. It makes me a complete geek. But when it comes to reading, I try to read four books literature or books I want to read. And then I'll read the fourth or fifth book, it'll be professional development. And then I'll read another 3 to 4 books that I want, you know, not that I don't want to read the professional development books, please don't misunderstand me, because I try to pick ones that are, you know, that I absolutely do want to read, but I do enjoy literature. So I just read a book, and maybe one of you all know the name of it, but it's about a Japanese girl who puts stuff in a plastic bag, ends up on the shores in Canada, and it's Read the Diary. What's the name of it? Yeah, it's a very good book. And so, it's written by two people in two narratives from two different people at two different times. And so that's what I was reading. But my next book is Dark Money. My mother is my reading book partner. And Dark Money talks about the Coke and other, you know, super PACs and how they've influenced politics, and it's called Dark Money.
Well, I can't resist to ask this question before we open it up to the audience. So if anyone has questions, if you want to start making your way to the mic, but have you decided what's going to be next after you retire?
Well, I'm going to sleep past 5 o'clock in the morning. My husband retired when I became TJAG, and because he couldn't work for me. So he likes to say my first official act as TJAG was to fire him. So I've been for the past, 4 years, the alarm goes off in the morning, and he's like, have a good day at work, honey. So I'm looking for that alarm clock not to go off at 5 a.m. for me to have to do my physical training in the morning. So that's my first thing. And then he and I have a couple trips planned. And I hope to write a couple, I'm going to write a couple articles. And then I have 2 children's books that I would like to write with my daughter, my oldest daughter's a teacher. And my youngest daughter she's in the finance industry, but she's an artist. So I'd like to do 2 books that I would like to do with them, coming from the storyteller background. And so they'll translate it into books. And Nonna, which is Italian for grandmother, will tell the stories. And so those are my short-term plans.
Questions from the audience?
Hi, my name is Chris Fairley, and I'm a student here at John Marshall in the Veterans Clinic. And my question pertains to the ESGR and the employment-related issues involving Guard and Reservists.
Okay.
And so we know that that program, the Ombudsman's Program, has volunteers, and they're very well-meant, but they're very poorly trained. So do you believe, or how do you feel about law school veterans clinics and ADR programs helping to supplement the ESGR and that program?
Okay. So, obviously every soldier and service member cares deeply about veterans issues. For a lot of folks, I don't understand that, I'm considered a veteran. Because once you finish your initial contract, you are then a veteran. So we are all of us in uniform that have completed one. We're veterans, and we have vested veterans' rights. Now, the fact we continue to serve, obviously, the active duty part of what we do takes primacy. But we know we are all veterans, and then at some point we will either retire or leave the service and become part of that community. But while we're on active duty as judge advocates, the statute doesn't permit us to provide legal services to veterans, only retirees. And so I am not as well versed in veterans' issues as I should be, particularly since I'm going to be one full-time very soon. So I feel ill-equipped to answer your question. But I would take, I'll have Taylor's taking notes in the back, but I'll have Taylor take it for the record. And you and I can talk afterwards, and you can explain to me your concerns. Because we do work with the veterans, not me personally, but our Soldier for Life program, which is what is the tie to the veterans organizations, the MSOs, the VSOs. They're the ones who work those issues, and so I can carry back your concern and talk to the Soldier for Life program manager and see if there's some way we can influence the issue. Okay.
Ma'am, Kevin Hull, class of 2000 here, been teaching legislative drafting and policy. Mm-hmm. Captain Lacey's a former student.
Was he any good?
Incredible.
Please.
Good. Congratulations on your award. If you can talk about testifying before Congress or even within your own branch, teaching the art of selection of words that have meaning into the practical application of legislation and policy. Mm-hmm. What was it like the first time that you had to be impaneled and address as a witness? And while you're traveling, please take notes, because I think a book about your own journey would be incredible to read. Thank you.
Okay, so as TJAG, I deal on a very, very regular basis with the Senate Armed Services Committee and the House Armed Services Committee. I also meet with members on a regular basis regarding issues of concern. And so last week I was on the Hill 2 days introducing myself to the new members of the HASC and the new members of the SASC, and also anybody that was a lawyer that had recently been elected to the Hill. And so I was there the week before 2 times. I was there this week 2 times. After I come back from travel, I'll go back up again. I had also held a conference down at the Judge Advocates Legal Center and School in Charlottesville, Virginia for 2 days with the HASC and SASC, HPSI, HOGAR, and a couple of other committees' general counsel. So why do they come to our school? Because we offer them CLE. And so they come for 2 days, they get to ask us, basically they give us an agenda of what they want to talk about. We then do presentations. And a lot of the lawyers on those, a lot of the ledge writers on those committees are lawyers. And so we have a lot of the legislative writers there too. And so a lot of the influencing and educating, really it's educating the Hill, is done through that informal network with both the HASC and SASC professional staff members, with the attorneys and legislative writers that are in those committees, and then with the members who have interest in certain issues that you go and visit. And that informal method is really how you can educate the Hill on issues. A member themselves have very little time to get up to speed on an issue. And so really it's their professional staff. The guys who are there, you know, they stay on the Hill regardless of member change out. Sometimes they change between members, or if they're on a committee, they often stay on that committee for years. And those are the folks who get depth into issues. And so you really spend time educating them. We also go up to the Hill and hold brown bag luncheons because we're not paying for your food. And we educate them on issues of interest to the Army as a whole that are legal in nature. Additionally, you can have something in the papers that becomes of interest to them. And then I have to become steeped in knowledge on that particular case. So let's say you read about a detainee and drill sergeant abuse case at, you know, Fort Jackson, South Carolina. Members want to know about that, and so I have to become steeped in that information, and I go and I speak to the member or the member or the SASC or HASC or whoever's asked the question. And that's how my education on the Hill mostly works. Additionally, you do have to testify on occasion, and that's typically about a specific issue. And so for me, it's been sexual assault in the military and the interest that the Hill has had on that issue and how our criminal code is written when we handle and how we handle sexual assault cases. And it's a lot like an oral argument at an appellate level, okay? So all of this and all of those influencing or educating forums that I just talked about, it's an oral argument. So you have to, before you prepare for an appellate oral argument, you obviously have to have become very steeped in the facts of that particular case, right? And then you have to anticipate knowing the judges on the panel based upon research, what questions you think those judges are going to ask you and what the basis of the question, so that while they may ask X, what they really want to know is why. And so they're trying maybe to walk you to why, but if you know they're trying to get to why, you answer X differently. And that's really the same method that you have to use when you're educating individuals when it comes to the Hill. And that's how I often will come back and say, when I was there on Tuesday, I was there for 8 hours. And I said, I just had an 8-hour oral argument. And I'm really tired. So unless it's important, don't ask me to make a decision. because that's what it's like. And I don't know if that helped answer your question or not.
Any final questions from the audience? Brian.
General, we've had to testify some of our staff in front of discharge boards, not with your branch. There seems to be, in some of the other branches, maybe perhaps in your branch, a bit of a misunderstanding as far, or a lack of knowledge as far as what a discharge status means for things like access to VA healthcare, compensation benefits, housing, employability, and things like that. Do you think there's anything that could be done in the education of some of our newer JAGs or some of our existing JAGs to extend that knowledge? Because we're finding people who come in seeking discharge upgrades who are quite often getting them granted, and it really changes their life. Mm-hmm. So any thoughts on that would be appreciated. Thank you.
All right, so part of our responsibility as judge advocates is actually to advise commanders who are the decision maker when it comes to administrative discharges. So in the military, for those of you who are not familiar with the system, you often hear the words dishonorable discharge. Okay, so a dishonorable discharge can only be given by a criminal court. It's a type of part of your sentence. Once you've been found guilty, you can receive either a bad conduct discharge, a dishonorable discharge, or no discharge. And that's based upon the crime that you have been found guilty of. Okay, so that's an actual part of your sentence, which is different than other courts. We also can take money and we can take rank. So it's a four-part sentence. Money, discharge, rank, and confinement. That's what a court can give in the military. Administrative discharges are just what they sound like. It's a process where you are discharged with due process, depending on your time in service. It could be limited due process if you've been in for under 6 years, where you only have the opportunity of notice and response. I love it when I talk to a legal audience because I can actually say this and use legal terms, minimal due process. As opposed to 6 years and over, or we want to give you a characterization of service that's called an other than honorable discharge, you then have the right to appear in person before that, a board of officers, okay? And so, or there could be enlisted if you're an enlisted, but they're senior. And so that's an administrative discharge with due process in part of it. Once all that's done, it's all recommendation. It comes into a commander who actually makes the decision. At that point, they have advice of an attorney. And that's part of what we do as judge advocates. They're required by law, if someone has served in a combat zone in the last 24 months, that they consider if they have a PTSD or a traumatic brain injury when they determine what characterization of service they're going to give the soldier if they decide to discharge them. And judge advocates, it's our responsibility when we advise them to inform them of what happens with each of the characterizations of service. And to be honest, we focus on the veterans, and that's the part we do know with the Veterans Administration, what services you get based upon those three types of discharge. Okay? So if there's been a determination that you're going to be separated, there's been a determination that there's been some typically misconduct if we're going for an other than honorable. And it is our responsibility at that point. Okay. So that's the part he's referring to. And so we do train on that. It's also important to know that every soldier gets an attorney who can advocate for them in the process. And so there is an assigned counsel for the soldier, and then there's a government counsel who advises the decision maker. And so while due process, administrative due process, and not a court necessarily, there is a process where each party is represented. And it's a hard decision for a commander to make. My experience is that if commanders are aware of a TBI or PTSD, they default to the discharge that allows them to have the VA benefits, but also will also not allow them to reenlist. Okay, because you have to remember, it's not about, they're not being discharged because of the PTSD and the TBI. There's a medical process for that. They're being discharged because of something that they've done that's inappropriate. So the commander has to take a look at both of those and ask himself two questions. Is this person's conduct for which I'm discharging them related or caused by their TBI and their PTSD? And the doctors help them make that decision. If the answer is no, then they have to say, do I want to deny them veterans benefits knowing that they have this medical condition that's caused by their service? And most commanders default to a characterization that allows them to have VA benefits. Now, do we consider housing? Do we consider employment? I think that is considered by commanders anytime they discharge. Also the loss of their GI benefits, which denies them then often the right to be able to use the benefits that they've accrued to go to college. And so they are informed of that and they do consider it. Do they get it right all the time? I think that they try to. I think we weren't as sensitive to the issue. We've gotten more sensitive to it as we've learned more about TBI and PTSD. And so I think we're better at it now than we were in the beginning. And so I would hope that when we have these conversations, maybe 5 years from now, that maybe we'll have noticed, you know, over the last 2 years, maybe a bit of a change in the way we're handling discharges. That would be my hope. But we can never lose sight of the fact that the soldier is being eliminated, and we have to also protect the institution that they are not able to come back in because of misconduct. And I think that's what you're referring to, misconduct discharges. There's other types of discharges.
Well, we are actually a little past time, so again, please join me in thanking the general for being here.
Thank you.